So I have been asked to give a lecture on tight control. So IBD tight control, this will lead to more complication or lesser complication. So before I start, just a few questions, just raising your hands without any voting system. Who from our audience here, I know that all of us are endoscopists, who from us are treating IBD patients? So yes, we have all, yes, something like 40%, 50%. Okay. From these people, who from you will start, when you see tomorrow a Crohn's patient or an ulcerative colitis patient, who will start conventional therapy? Yes. So I need a mic, please. Can I have a mic? Extra mic. ممكن ميكروفون؟ شباب. ميكروفون من القاعة. دكتور حسين بيه. Why you will start conventional therapy?
Before starting treatment of any patient with Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, we have to do what's called risk stratification of the patient. So the patient is high-risk patient and low-risk patient. You know that we have the stop-down treatment and step-up treatment. If we apply the step-down treatment for all patients, we have, so we'll over-treat some patients with mild disease.
This is very important.
In patients with mild disease, we have to start with conventional therapy.
So from Dr. Hussein here, he's with the concept of doing what I will explain a little bit later about the step-up approach. So start by the conventional therapy, and then if there is this patient is a higher risk of this patient is complicating, we go to the higher level. Who is already supporting this idea of, like Professor Hussein? Yes, okay. So on the other side, who is supporting to start early biological treatments, just for example, TNF blockers or others. Who will start early? Yes, doctora. ممكن مايك هنا للدكتورة؟ ما فيش مايك للدكتورة. Who else? Who else will start early biologicals? No one? Yeah, please, mic هنا.
هو في predictors للسيفيريتي بتاعت ال في بريدكتور زي الايج لو اكستنسيف من الاول لو له البومين لو الماركر هاي لو ادميتد هوسبيتال لو على كورتيكوسترويد بهاي دوز لكن الجايد لاينز لو مودريت تو سيفير لو مودريت تو سيفير انفلاماتوري باول من الاول ممكن ابدا بايولوجيكال ثيرابي ده
يعني
طبعا هو في لسه انديكيشنز فيه يعني لو هو على كورتيكوسترويد من الاول وفيلير مش ريسبونسر مش ريسبوند ايرلي
اوكي سو وي هاف اي ويل سي
دكتور مصطفى بليز
يس بليز دكتور عزيز
وات يو كونسيدر اباوت ايرلي يوز وات ذا مينينج اوف ايرلي
اباوت سوري
ايرلي
ايرلي مينز ايرلي سو وين يو دايجنوز يور بيشنت جاست افتر ذا دايجنوز اوف ذا بيشنت تو ستارت One of this.
Yes, you mean that immediately?
Yes.
I think the question, big difference. I think the old step up, now we have what's called accelerated step up, and okay. Considered as an early within 3 to 6 months, but immediate.
Not okay, but not immediate. After diagnosis, and after yes. I will say few weeks of steroids, you are with the idea of starting early biologicals.
That is according to Professor Hussein said, we have from the start bad prognostic factors and bad risk factors.
Okay.
And you assess them, then you start the patient will.
Okay. So from what I got on the three questions, that we have 50% of us here doing treating IBD patients, and this already, again, is the message that Egypt doesn't have a lot of IBD patients. So we have a lot of IBD patients now. Then most of you will do the conventional therapy, which is where you will go, and then you will do the step up if needed, but Professor Hussein said a very important point that we two things. He didn't want any complication. This is so safety is a very hallmark about what I'm going to say today, as well as second point. He said we don't want to over treat patient. Okay, you have a comment.
Yes. When considering the treatment of the patient, of course you have other factors that. In the back of your mind, are you willing to start biologic or you're willing to start conventional? You have, from the beginning, from the time you see the patient, you say, I will consider biologics in this patient and I will start give him a chance to give conventional and so. For me, when I ever see a child, I am into biologics. I try to find the factors that push me into biologics. But when I see an older patient, I find factors that push me towards the conventional. Because you are afraid most of the time of the extra intestinal manifestations and the gross and other factors.
So this goes again with what had been said here of risk stratification. So you will assess the risk, individualization of the treatment. You will assess this patient and then you will start. Okay. So I think just grabbing all of what we have said in the last 5 minutes, all of us, the idea now is, or the new concept, which is treat to target, targeting exactly what Khurshid had said, targeting which patient to do which. So our main aim for all of this is what? Is to avoid complication. So we don't want to have our patient to a future complication and future disability, because this is a chronic disease. This is not a disease which will be treated in 1 week. So the idea is to have a better future quality of life. Again, so the concept again is goal oriented, exactly like what Dr. Khurshid had just said. We need to put a target for each patient and to put the goal of this patient and then to start adapting how to treat this. And the concept is there in many other diseases. So the idea of targeting first, who to treat, how to treat, and then after that, the hallmark is not only this. I will never write even steroids to a patient without following up. So this is one of the problems in our country. When we start treatment for such chronic patients, we need to monitor this. And then the third important point is to modify. So we need to follow up our patient, and if any modification should be done. The concept is there in other diseases. So for example, we know when you see a diabetic patient or our endocrinologist friends, they will have a target in their mind. You will never find that an endocrinologist says, okay, I want to treat diabetes. He had a very specific SMART target, which is, for example, hemoglobin A1C less than 7. Same for hypertension, same for dyslipidemia. So all other chronic diseases, they have a target which they would like to reach. Again, more and more for example, in this chronic disease like rheumatoid arthritis. So how to do the same like our endocrinologists are doing in hypertension and diabetes to put a target in IBD patients? So it's about inflammation. We know that both diseases, Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis are an inflammatory process, a chronic inflammatory process, which if we didn't treat correctly, it will lead to complication and disability for this patient. And then the whole more comes about this point. It's about bowel damage. So this few years ago, everything changed. So it's not about, again, not about symptoms anymore and not about numbers, not about figures. I remember a very good advice from my mentor in Belgium that he told me, Mustafa, we don't treat images, we treat patients. So maybe sometimes you have a very good symptoms and very good lab, but again, you should think about now how or all of this time the inflammation is affecting the bowel and the inflammation of bowel. So this is the normal theoretical pathway of an IBD patient, where you have, especially Crohn's, you have the onset, and then the patient is diagnosed with an acute exacerbation effect, and then we see the patient theoretically. We will treat the patient. And this is the message we have learned for me 15 years ago when I was in my residency. Okay, Mustafa, when you see an IBD patient, tell him, okay, you will be a patient for life and you will have many, many attacks in the future. This is the theoretical part. So exacerbation, some remission, some exacerbation again. But again, this is a very good evidence showed a couple of years ago that over the long term of such patient, we still have ongoing affection of the bowel and the bowel damage. For example, after 5 years, so 50%, almost 50% of this patient in this study had shown bowel damage. So this is exactly what Professor Hussain had said, is the step-up approach. We start the patient, it depends on which patient, the ulcerative colitis or the Crohn's disease, ASA, steroids, azathioprines, and then biological when we have failure, and then surgery. This had been the concept before. But again, the question here for my friends, chairperson, when we will know before the complication that really there is a severe bowel damage in all this pyramid? It's a difficult one.
Actually, it's difficult, but close follow-up to the patient, putting a schedule according to the calm, looking for the calprotectin, the CRP, the ultrasound of the bowel, the endoscopy, you can easily predict. But the most important thing is to know where you're starting. What's the baseline of the calprotectin? What's the baseline of the CRP if it's positive in any of them? And putting the patient in close follow-up and letting the patient know that even the smallest symptom might indicate something coming through, that's very important. So educating the patient and close follow-up is the main theme of follow-up of the patient and avoiding the complications.
And Professor Azdet,
Professor
Hussein said a few minutes ago that he didn't think that if we go all of us to biologicals from the immediate, as you said, he is afraid of over-treating patients. Aren't you afraid of under-treating patients going by this conventional pyramid?
I think that is one of the mistakes in using step-up that may be sometimes under-treating. But let us speak that when you put the patient even in conventional, you are passing to the machine of treat to target. Even the convention will be under the schedule of that. And according to treat to target, you have to get the triple of assessment.
Yes.
That is the clinical and biochemical, and plus what you can do, the MRI, the endoscopy and biopsy, that is how to assess and expect the bowel damage.
So the message from here that we need to really assess when we start the patient, as you both you said. So it's not about, okay, I have some diarrhea and blood, and then we start the, no, so we need to assess clinically, biologically, and lab or endoscopy. So all the picture to really to be able to follow up this patient. So this is exactly the slide. So it's about if it's only symptoms, so we can have, a very easily control of symptom, but this is, doesn't mean that really we have what we would like really to have is the mucosal healing and deep remission. So it's our target is really having true mucosal healing, not only just the patient had no symptoms. So this is one of the very recent meta-analyses assessing mucosal healing and the long-term outcome in ulcerative colitis patient. And this is clearly shown that it's when you have a true deep mucosal healing, you have a better long-term. So again, taking the concept of mucosal healing and this deep mucosal healing going, because as we know, it's an ongoing process with accumulation of inflammatory markers all through. So there is a big question here, I think for my knowledge, and then I will ask my chairperson here, between the big disconnection between symptoms only, if diarrhea stopped or if bleeding stopped, and the true mucosal healing. So I think Professor Azza just answered this, that it's a combination of everything. It's not only symptoms. Yes?
Let us speak again, that is, there is poor correlation between endoscopic finding and clinical symptoms from the start. And he considers all the score we use in CD as a reference for research. But let us speak, they add now what's called Lehman score. That's
yes.
It's a very advanced one, help you to assess any part of the gut regarding the mucosal beyond the symptom treatment, symptoms, biochemical, and as you said.
Okay. So this will put us for the second step. Again, it's not only symptoms. So two more very important inflammatory marker. One of them is serum and is a blood test, and the other one is a stool test, is CRP and calprotectin. So as me and the chairperson said, it's about the combination of everything. So having symptoms, having an endoscopic true inflammation, and having an elevated CRP and an elevated calprotectin. Another just an Egyptian question. Do you think here in Egypt, just for the floor, please, we are overusing or underusing calprotectin? Any comment? Yes, please. Overusing, why? So if the patient is not related to IBD, you should don't do a calprotect. So a question, I'm a patient, I'm 39 years old. I will come to you, abdominal pain for the last 4 years, have been treated by a friend, PPI, no change, only abdominal pain, few attacks of diarrhea every now and then. You will do for me calprotect or not?
Actually, I don't, but there is a lot of physicians do that.
Okay. Any other comment?
Let me say something, Professor Mustafa. Let's be sure that calprotectin is an investigation for follow-up. It's not for diagnosis. However, you can predict some papers shown last year that when it's over 500, for example, you have a very high probability of IBD and so. So, of course, doing calprotectin is important. It may open a closed door or open a closed box. But using the calprotectin, overusing, I don't think, because it's not a cheap investigation, and most probably it's only ordered by pure gastroenterologists, not internal medicine, not general practitioners, of course. So, of course, there's underuse of calprotectin, and it's a very important tool to predict that there is something going on that's serious and needs more concentration, and maybe needs colonoscopy afterwards.
This is exactly, again, which will take us for the second level of thinking, modification. So sometimes we think that already we are here. We think that already that we have done the best mucosal healing and the patient is in deep remission. But again, follow-up, as exactly Dr. Khorshid said, that when you do a very good monitoring and follow-up for this patient, you prevent future problems. So I try to be more fast because we have five more minutes. So again, this is the newer concept nowadays, that when we treat early the patient, we can, and this in this window phase, we can really change even the future and the follow-up of this patient, and this will put us for early intervention. So can we really do early treatment for IBD patients, early intervention? This will take us to a very two famous studies, the REACT and the CALM, where they compared, the first one, they compared the very algorithmic treatment approach versus early combination of immunotherapy. And they showed that they have a low rate of serious complications in this early immunotherapy group rather than the conventional one. But again, to assess this mucosal healing and to assess, as I said, and to assess this true vanish of this inflammation, it's especially in Crohn's disease, so it's the combination of everything. And this is where the new CALM study, Colombel did a very good study and have been published a couple of years ago. And this is the first study there where they assessed, they randomized the patients, I will put it here. So they randomized the patient, only one of them is only on the clinical index, and the other one is clinical index and calprotectin and CRP. And both of them, they have both groups, if they have steroids before, steroids will be tapered before the start of randomization, and then anti-TNF will be started in both groups. So this is the randomization where they have the two groups, so the three to target where they assess the clinical outcome and the CRP and fecal calprotectin versus only the clinical management. So you can see clinical difference in the endoscopic remission between the two groups. This is the sub-group analysis of the study where you have in each, so the remission and an endoscopic remission and then endoscopic remission in each segment. Also, this is the clinical comparison of the clinical remission between both groups. And then finally, flare-up. So you have more flare-up when you go for this, I will say, assessment only of the clinical part. Just finally, before I finish, this was the concept. So this is simple screenshot of what was happening. People before were only assessing clinical remission. Now it's more and more about mucosal healing as well as endoscopic remission. Safety is an important issue. So this is answer Professor Hussain's comment. So we should not over-treat our patient because safety and complication of all. So there is zero medication in the world with zero complication. So we should always think about safety in our patient. But again, this study from Colombel opened for us a new concept that we should not only assess the clinical part, but we should think about all the picture. So the picture is put me to summarize my presentation. So we need to think about our patient as a goal-oriented patient. So what we need to really, in this special patient, and we should have this goal very clear. So the three words which I always think about, we should treat our patient early to avoid complication and to avoid future problem for this patient, and to be safe. So safety is another hallmark. We should think always about safety when we use a medication to be sure that this medication is safe to our patient and finally, sure, effective. Thank you very much.
Thank you.